Please rise as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who makes all things new, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Trusting in God's mercy, let us confess our sin. Holy One, source of our renewal, we confess that we are wrapped up in sin and have turned in ourselves. We have not practiced your righteousness. Our hearts have turned away from you. For the sake of the world you so love, forgive us that we may be reconciled with one another for the glory of your holy name. Thus says our God, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. God's mercy makes us new. We are forgiven in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. Let us pray. O God, the strength of all who hope in you, because we are weak mortals, we accomplish nothing good without you. Help us to see and understand the things we ought to do, and give us grace and power to do them through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
So I do see that we have a new friend back here, so I have a story. If you would like to come close, you can, and come sit up here, right in the front pew, or you can stay back there, whichever you're more comfortable with. It's all good. But I do have a story, and it's the story we're going to hear in a little bit from Deacon Ansel. Are you going to come up? I will wait for you. She's like, I'm not so sure. That's okay, too. Hey, parents, can I give a... Oh, right here, so you can see it. Yep. Can I give a temporary tattoo? That's okay? All right, good. Cool. Thank you. All right. This is called Jesus Teaches About Anger. Not that you ever get angry, right? But some of us adults sometimes get angry. Okay. One day, Jesus was teaching a crowd of people. He explained some very good ways to treat others with love and respect. Do not call other people names, Jesus said. He explained that using unkind names hurts people's feelings. Jesus continued, if you are angry with someone, talk to them about what makes you angry. Work the problem out and forgive each other. Forgiveness shows love. The people nodded, listening to what Jesus was saying. Treat your family members and friends politely and kindly, Jesus said. Kindness and respect are important. Use God's name respectfully too. Use it only for worship and praise. God's name is special. And then actually, so Jesus goes on. So I'm going to go on to the next story because Jesus has kind of a lot to say on what's called the Sermon on the Mount. So next, he says something kind of hard. He says that you should love your enemies. So Jesus taught people everywhere about God, and he was teaching about how we should treat our enemies. Jesus said, if someone hurts you, don't hurt them back. That's really hard, yeah. If someone, that was different. Then Jesus said, if someone asks you for help, say, sure. People hadn't always thought like that before. And remember to share what you have with other people. Jesus had the people thinking. Then Jesus said a very important thing. Everyone says, love your friends and hate your enemies. I say to you, love your enemies and pray for people who are mean to you. This is what really makes God happy. So I wanted to read that for you today because when Deacon Ansel, right here, when he reads the story for the adults here, it's going to tell us all these things that we should do. And it's going to say, don't only not murder, right? You know that you're not supposed to murder. Pretty basic, right? But he says, don't even say unkind things. And don't make things harder on other people. But treat people always with kindness. Because even though I think no one here has murdered anyone, we all sometimes say unkind things. We just do, right? But we can all work to make the world a better place by being kind to another. So I have something for you. Ah, there they are. Woo! So this is a temporary tattoo, and you can't tell until you put it on because it's, you know, flipped inside out, right? But when you put it on, it will tell you that you are a sinner, which we all are, because we all make mistakes. Like, it's not just those bad people over there. We all make mistakes, so we're a sinner. But then when you look at it the other way around, it says saint. Huh. It says that even though we are sinners, we can still do wonderful things as a child of God. So I'm going to give this to you as a reminder, okay? But before I give it to you, can you help me pray? That we, how we do this at Epiphany is that I will say a little bit and then you'll repeat after me, but it's not just you. The rest of you will help, right? Okay, good, good. All right, then let us pray. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For your son, Jesus.
For your son, Jesus.
Who showed us.
Who showed us.
How to love one another.
How to love one another.
And make this world.
And make this world.
A better place.
A better place.
For all people.
For all people.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. A tattoo and you're an adult, you can get one too. Just let me know after the service. I do have some announcements to share with us today. First to say that I see Jeremy has his arms full. Oh, and Elaine too, there are ushers today and they're going to come give you the welcome pads. And on those welcome pads, we invite you to write your name and any other information it asks for. Especially if any of it has changed, so we might delight in your presence among us and follow up with you as we're able. If you are one of the people who is joining us online, we invite you to comment and say that you are here, and so that we can delight in your presence among us as well. There are lots of prayers listed in the Herald this week. You'll see that the Herald is shorter this week. It kind of got long during COVID times because we had a lot to communicate and people weren't able to come here and hear much, right? So we wanted to make sure we got it all in here. But there was a request that we might try to get it back down to one page, to one sheet, and we did. But we can only do one sheet or two sheets, so it's like a big difference. So if you see things that are missing, that's why. We'll probably alternate between them as makes sense based on how much information we had, but that's why. In this, we always make sure to include our prayer list, so we invite you to pray along with us throughout your week so that when you are rising in the morning and doing your devotions or you're going to bed at night, you have the people that you might pray for. I will note specifically that we have been praying for the recovery of Don Watson, and I just saw him walk in. So we delight in Don's presence with us today. It's a very good thing. So we invite you to continue to pray that others might experience healing. And you have a cane, right, Don?
Absolutely.
That's for your support, not to hit anyone, right? Okay, good. Very good. all right, there was a Valentine's dinner last night. Thank you to everyone who came, everyone who hosted, everyone who made delicious food. It was a wonderful evening. So thank you. The silent auction that we have each year is over for the year. If you have not yet picked up your items, there is one table left of items that have yet to be picked up. You have a week left. Otherwise, we go to the next highest bidder. In a week and a half, Lent begins. Lent begins, of course, with Ash Wednesday. While we have service most every Wednesday here at Epiphany, in a week and a half, it will be our Ash Wednesday service. We will have the imposition of ashes. So we invite you to come and be a part of that worship service. If you are one of those people who want to wear your ashes proudly but humbly all day long, you are invited to come between 7:45 a.m. and 8:30 a.m. To receive your ashes right out here at RASP, on RASP at the courtyard. And then also on Ash Wednesday, we will not have a pancake supper this year. However, we will have Bible study that night. And it is a special night for our Bible study because we are finally beginning the New Testament. We've been in the Old Testament for about a year and 8 months, and we're ready. We are so ready, beginning with the first half of the Gospel of Mark that night. And then the following Wednesday, so starting on March 1st, and then for all five Wednesdays in March, we will have a daytime Bible study at 11 a.m. in the parlor, and, except when we're kicked out, and go to 106 and 08 when there's Ruth's Circle. But Pastor Carl Myers will be leading a study for those 5 weeks on the Lord's Prayer. And so you're invited to come and be a part of that. If you'd like to bring your lunch with you after the study finishes for the day, you can eat with those who have gathered and brought their lunches as well. And then finally, there are innumerable opportunities to serve. You can serve by bringing in food. You can serve by serving food or packaging food with loaves and fishes, or by packaging and delivering food for getting food out into the community with school families. You can volunteer with our after-school program that is now entering its fourth week this Wednesday. There are all kinds of ways that you can serve. And so if you have questions about that, certainly you can look at the Herald, but you can also come and ask me questions, or honestly, you can ask lots of people here questions about that, and we'll be sure to fill you in. All right. Very good. And now at this time, we turn our attention to reading from God's Word.
A reading from Deuteronomy. Moses said to the people, "See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord, your God, that I am commanding you today by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and to serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish, and you shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
St. Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, 'You shall not murder,' and 'Whoever murders shall be liable to judgment.' But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, 'You fool,' you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before you go to the altar, and go first to be reconciled to your brother or sister. and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are on the way to court with him, or your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly, I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. And if your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than your whole body to go to hell. It was also said that whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife except on the grounds of unchastity causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or beneath, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great King. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot one here white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Deacon Ansel just gave me a look like, good luck. Thank you. I don't pick these readings, by the way, right? Yeah, that's provided by the lectionary. I wasn't thinking, I want to tell everyone to cut off their hands today. You know, I think we too often underestimate one another. We don't expect much from one another. We don't expect our neighbors to notice when our patterns change. We don't expect teachers to take extra time with a struggling student. We don't expect our city to grow and thrive or be safe. We don't expect elected leaders who actually see themselves as public servants. We don't expect our parents or grandparents to change how they see us and accept the fullness of who we are. We don't expect war to end and peace to reign. Now, we want all those things, right? We want all those things to happen, sometimes desperately so, and sometimes that longing leads to complaining. Not solution-seeking, not problem-solving, not collaboration, but complaining about all that is broken, seemingly beyond repair. But Jesus, in what he says today, as harsh as it sounds in our ears, Jesus is pointing out that we have a role in all those things we want to complain about. Jesus is holding all of us to a higher standard. Yes, of course, don't murder. right? But before we can even get to that point, we need to stop pointing the finger, escalating tension and judgment and violence. Yes, of course, we shouldn't break the covenant of marriage. But before we can even get there, let us not let lust rule in our hearts. Yes, divorce is sometimes the best course of action. But let us not casually dispose of people, especially the most vulnerable. In fact, this whole conversation reminds me of a conversation I had just a couple of weeks ago with someone who was here for a funeral. In fact, Carolyn Yost's funeral. We had gone to a luncheon afterwards, and I got into this conversation with a relative, and it wasn't long before I found out that he was a retired cop. Not only was he a retired cop, but he was in the Drug Enforcement Division and then the Homicide Division in Southeast Baltimore, where I live. And I admit to you that my expectations were low. I expected him to complain. I expected him to talk about how horrible the city is these days, because I hear it plenty, because we aren't being tough enough on criminals. And you know what he did? Well, he did lament, but then he immediately talked about the need, the deep need to address the underlying causes of violence in our city. I underestimated him. I assumed that he would look at the horrible statistics and he would say, it's gone bad and it can't be saved. Instead, he spoke from a deep experience of what could happen in order to change the situation we are in. That when we're just going after the symptoms, the perpetrators of violent crime, then it's not going to get any better. But we need to know our communities, talk to families of victims, form relationships, people who can help officers solve crime and slowly work to transform our communities. And for that matter, there are things we need to do long before any crime is committed. We need to again do after-school programs and little leagues. He talked, as someone familiar with Epiphany, he talked about 50 years ago. 50 years ago. Good old days, right? 50 years ago, when Epiphany had an after-school program called the Tuesday Night Youth Program. Some of you remember that, in fact. And he pointed out that when Epiphany had that program that was thriving, that had hundreds of kids making their way through this building doing candle making and painting, that Epiphany, though unique, was not alone. There were after-school programs in every community across the city, raising people in community, raising people to know one another, to be supported and loved and cared for. He spoke of the need for a strategy to seriously address the underlying causes of violence in our city. I know that the language that we hear from Jesus can sound harsh, but the truth is that Jesus, too, is going for the underlying causes of the violence we see in our world, that it is too easy for us to point at those people over there doing all the horrible things without looking in the mirror and recognizing where we are falling short. And in truth, he was only doing what others in the rabbinic tradition did before him. Jesus is going through the law, through the Old Testament. He is quoting from Exodus, Deuteronomy, Leviticus, Numbers, Isaiah, the Psalms, Exodus, Leviticus, pulling all of these forward and then taking the strictest interpretation of the law in order to raise the bar, to raise the stakes. You have a part to play. They need to do better. We need to do better. In fact, it does not just stop with Jesus. Luther, 1,500 years later, does much the same thing when he, in the small catechism, don't go anywhere without your trusty small catechism, friends, right? In the small catechism, Luther says, as we hear today, you shall not murder. Good. And then he goes on to explain, we are to fear and love God so that we neither endanger nor harm the lives of our neighbors, but instead help and support them in all of life's needs. It is not enough to not murder one another. We need to know our neighbors. We need to seek out reconciliation in our families, in our neighborhoods, in our church. Now, we don't get to hear the rest of what Jesus says in this sermon on the Mount in this vein. The rest of you have heard it said, but I tell you, because it happens next week, in the years that Epiphany season is long enough, but it's not this year. So it goes on and it has some familiar words that you will recognize, I'm sure. It includes, you have heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, if anyone strikes you on the cheek, turn the other also. He also says that you have heard it said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Finally, ending with my favorite commandment in the whole Bible, because it's just so darn ridiculous. Finally, Jesus says, be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Now, this isn't just Jesus setting up an impossibly high standard, though it is, right? None of us can be perfect, forcing us to recognize that we all need the grace of God, that it's not just the murderers and the slanderers, it's not just the adulterers and people who are cheating on their taxes, it is all of us who need the grace of God in our lives, but Jesus also lays out for us the root of all that is broken in the world. And then gives us some agency to do something about it. We don't need to just complain about all that is wrong. We have a role to play, so be bold in faith. Mentor young people in our after-school program. Maybe you'll create a path you could not have foreseen for a young person. Get involved in your neighborhood association, as some of you here are. You might build something for the next generation that is better than the hardship we now witness. Come volunteer with loaves and fishes. Feed the people of our community that we too might witness a moment like the feeding of the 5,000 and raise a generation of people who see the church as a place where they will be fed physically and spiritually. Dedicate your life to serving young people and their families, to not only make sure they are educated, but their families get the resources they need, as happens at the Judy Center. Take time in your busy week to deliver food to families, to school families, that they have the food they need. You are boldly doing the work that Jesus commands. Changing the world. And know that while you boldly seek to follow Jesus, while you choose life despite all the obstacles, God will over and over again choose you as a beloved child of God. In Jesus' name,
amen.
Amen.
Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Good and gracious God, we gather as church across the land to worship you. Teach us to honor you and to love and obey your will. We recognize our shortcomings and our failures. We do not love others as you would have us to do. Help us to treat all people as a sibling in Christ, to bring out their best. We ask your blessing on the congregation of Vicar Christopher Robinson and the congregation of Living Grace in Urbana, Maryland, as they work on ministry together. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God of life, we remember before you our neighboring congregations, Jerusalem Lutheran, Messiah Episcopal, and Lutheran. Empower their ministries so that they can bring more people to know you and adore you. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God of grace, bless our council as it meets this afternoon, as well as all our committees and work groups. Guide their efforts so that they are meaningful to your will and our mission in Northeast Baltimore. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God of love, we ask your special blessings on the Lutheran disaster response as they mobilize to help the earthquake victims of Turkey and Syria. Guide those who wish to help, that their contributions may best serve the needs of those most impacted. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God of hope, we ask your blessings and comfort on those in need. Where possible, grant that healing may come to those on our prayer list and those who name aloud or in the quiet corners of our hearts.
Howa, Ron, Tommy, Francine, Kathy, Gary.
Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God of promise, your goodness is everlasting. We give thanks for the lives of the faithful who now rest in you. We trust that you will bring us on that last day into the company of all the saints with rejoicing. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We bring to you our needs and hopes, O God. Trust in your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share the peace.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Power and
might, heaven
of your glory, Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he
who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed are you, O God, and blessed is your love for us in Jesus Christ. You have given us your love in every generation. You have commissioned us as servants of Christ for all peoples. In the night when he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took a cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it for them all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all peoples for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." So, Father, with this bread and cup, we celebrate his love, his death, his risen life, as we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Send your Holy Spirit that these gifts of bread and cup may be for us Christ's body and blood. As you feed us with these gifts, make us more to be more and more like Jesus, our Savior. Help us, Father, to love one another, as we look forward to that day when suffering is ended and all creation is gathered in your loving arms. And now with all the angels and all your saints, we give you glory through Christ, our Lord, who taught us when we pray to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him by faith with thanksgiving in your hearts, and be grateful.
Amen. I invite you to be seated. You'll be invited to come forward at the direction of our ushers. We will have the bread, which is the body of Christ, there at the baptismal font. And so whichever side you are coming from, you will go there first. And then you will go to the side you came from to receive the red wine and white grape juice from the person on your side. The first cup you get to, so the one closest to the inside, to the middle of the church, should be red wine. And the one on the outside should be white grape juice. And then also, I will be here on the side to pray with anyone who would like that moment of prayer before or after receiving communion. So if you have something to on your mind that you'd like to pray for, just let me know, and I will gladly pray with you. You should know that this is not Epiphany's table. It is not even a Lutheran table. It is the Lord's table, and all are welcome at this feast.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Thank you.
And now may the holy and precious body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in true faith to everlasting life.
Amen.
Amen. May the God of glory dwell in you richly, name you beloved, and shine brightly on your path. And the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit begin with you now and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
God is love.
Amen.